Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, I'm going to talk about IQ variation. So, IQs vary. People get different IQ scores. And in terms of assessment, this is a good thing. This is what we want. Remember, I said if we had an IQ test where everyone got the same score, then it wouldn't really be telling us anything about those people. So, we want to be able to differentiate people. We want to see that they do have different abilities and different skills. And so, a good IQ assessment will give us a broad range of different scores. Now, in doing this, in making these finer distinctions between people, we might wonder if we've created some artificial distinctions. So, we might wonder if there's a practical difference between people with slightly different IQ scores. So, for instance, if a person scores 102 on an IQ test and another person scores 104, we might wonder if there's really a practical difference in their abilities or not. At the same time, we could wonder about the fact that many people will have the same IQ scores. So if we pick an IQ score like 100, you know, which is the average IQ score, then there will be lots and lots of people who have that same exact score. But of course, that doesn't mean that those people all have identical cognitive abilities. So we'll think about how other ways people differ might influence how they apply that intelligence. And that's something that we'll look at when we talk about personality traits in the next unit. Okay, so if we were to look at all of the IQ scores for a particular assessment, this would tell us the distribution of IQ scores in a population. So what does the distribution of IQ scores look like? Well, if we look at the distribution of IQ scores, we find that it follows a normal distribution. And this is something that I talked about in the chapter on research methods. So you might want to review that video. But basically, this is the idea that you have the mean, the median, and the mode all at the center of the distribution, and it's symmetrically distributed on either side. So what that means is that for IQ, the mode, which is the most common score, is 100. And that means that's also the average score. So if you add up all the scores and divide by the number of people, that gives you the mean. And in the case of IQ, it will also be 100. And we also have the median, which is 100. So in a normal distribution, all of these are the same. And in the case of IQ, they're all 100. So the median score, again, is if you line up all the scores in order, and then you pick the one that falls exactly in the middle, then in the case of IQ, that would be 100. Okay, we can also calculate a standard deviation for IQ. And for IQ, the standard deviation is about 15 points. So to refresh your memory on standard deviation, this is the idea that it tells us how different each score is from the average score. So, you know, some people are going to score very close to 100, so it's going to be a small difference from 100. Other people are going to score farther away from 100. They're going to be much higher or much lower than 100. And then what you do is you take the average of all of those differences. So you look at how much each score differs from 100, then you average all of those differences, and in the case of IQ, that will give you a standard deviation of about 15. Okay, so let's take a look at a chart here showing this. Okay, so here's our normal distribution for IQ scores. And what you can see is we have the score of 100 here, which is the most frequent, right? So this is the score on this axis here, and there's not an axis drawn here, but this is the frequency of that score. So this is a frequency distribution. And we can see that the most common score, the highest frequency, is 100, and that is also going to be the mean and the median, because if we look, the scores are symmetrical on either side. So the middle point is going to be right here at 100. Okay, so as we move away, you know, one standard deviation will be here, that's 15 points below. Two standard deviations below would be here, three would be here, and on the other side, we have the same thing. This would be one standard deviation, this would be two, and this would be three. And of course, there's a, you know, these tails continue off of the picture here. But okay, so let's take a look at what this means in terms of interpreting somebody's score. So if we're looking at somebody's score on this, how do they compare to the rest of people who have taken an IQ test? Well, if we look here, between a score of 85 and 100, so this section of the line here, this section of people, this is going to be about 34% of people. That's what I've labeled down here. So about 34% of the population will score between 85 and 100. That's one standard deviation. Now on this side, the same is true. In a standard deviation above the mean, about 34% of people will score between 100 and 115. And what that means is that you can look at this total section from 85 to 115, and that means you're going to have about 68% of people score in that range. So the majority of people are going to score between 85 and 115 on an IQ test, nearly 70%. Now, if we extend to another standard deviation out here, we say, okay, what about going all the way from 85 down to 70? We see that that's going to be about 13.5% of people will score in this range. And the same is true over here for this 115 to 130. About 13.5% of people will score between 115 and 130 on an IQ test. And so we can, again, take a look at this whole section here from 70 all the way up to 130, and that means we'll have about 95% of people in that range. So almost everyone is going to score between 70 and 130 on an IQ test, but you can see there's still a few people left here at the very extremes here. So when we get below 70, we now have only about 2% of people will score below 70 and higher than 55. So in this range here. And then on the other side, above 130 up to 145, we'll have about 2% of people. And that means, again, if we add up all of these scores, so from 55 to 145, we'll have pretty much everybody in the population. At that point, we'll have 99.7% of people. Now, I know with these numbers, it doesn't add up to exactly 0.7, but these are estimates. So it's about 99.7. And then that means that at the very extremes here, we have like 0.1%, maybe a little more, maybe a little less, of people score below 55, and like 0.1% of people score above 145. So if you hear somebody tell you, no, their IQ is a 200 or something, you know, they're probably lying. I mean, it's possible, but very, very unlikely. It's a very, very small fraction of the population that scores above 145. And another important point about these is not only are these really small percentages of the population at these extremes, but that it's very unreliable at this point. It's very hard to measure people once they get, you know, three standard deviations above or below the mean. Now, in the case of very high IQ, you can see that, you know, if somebody's scoring 160 or so, you might wonder, well, who's creating the test that they can really tell? You know, how do you design questions for somebody who's really that brilliant? And how can you do it in a reliable way? So if they took the test again, where they get the same score, and that's actually unlikely to happen. When people get really, really high scores here, if they take the test again, they might have a big change in their score. They'll probably still be quite high, but it's less reliable at the extremes. And the same is true down here, and it's maybe a little bit easier to think about when you think about being below 55, and you wonder, well, how can you really differentiate people at that point? I mean, the difference between 50 and 45, this is the point where, you know, you can barely get people to, you know, follow any instructions. You know, there's going to be very, very little that they're able to do. And so to be able to differentiate people in terms of different skills at that point, it's going to be very difficult. And those scores are also going to be unreliable. Okay, so that's our overall distribution of IQ scores. And I've also sort of given you this idea of percentile score. So when you get a percentile score, that tells you how many people are to the left of you on this graph. So if you were to look at this and say, okay, I scored 100 on an IQ test, so I'm right here, what's my percentile score? Your percentile score would be, well, how many people scored lower than you? And since you're right at the middle here, you know it's 50%, so you'd be at the 50th percentile. Whereas if you go over here, you say, okay, I scored a 115 on an IQ test, what percentile is that? And that would be about the 84th percentile. So you'd basically be going through and adding up, it'd be 34 plus 34 plus 13.5 plus 2 plus 1. Everybody to the left, that would be about 84% of people to your left, and that means you'd be at the 84th percentile. And so when you get way out here, you know, at, you know, 145 or something, then you're at like the 99.9 percentile, right? Very, very high. Whereas when your IQ score is below average, then you're going to be at a lower and lower percentile, right? If you're at, you know, 70, you're going to be, you know, around the second or third percentile. Okay, so that's the idea of percentile scores. And if you've taken the SAT before, you've probably gotten a percentile score. And that's essentially telling you where you are on the distribution. What point are you on this line? Are you here? Are you here? Etc. Okay, so that's the idea of percentile score. All right, so what do IQ scores mean? What can we say about the variation in IQ? Well, Well, we'll start with thinking about what high IQ means. So, as I've said in a previous video, there are several positive outcomes that are associated with higher IQ. So it's correlated to a number of things, and these include better academic performance. People with higher IQs are more likely to achieve higher levels of education. They're more likely to have higher status jobs. They're more likely to earn more income, and they're more likely to do better at their jobs. They're more likely to have higher job performance ratings. All right, so these are all positive outcomes that are correlated with high IQ. Now, you might wonder about this and say, well, you know, these things all seem to be related to each other, right? All of these things that you're predicting. So we can say that high IQ is a good predictor of future success. But you might say, well, okay, it helps you get good grades, and those good grades help you get into a good college, and then getting into a good college gives you better job opportunities, and those better job opportunities allow you to earn more money, and so maybe that's just all comes down to a high IQ helped you get good grades. And that might be partly true. I mean, these things are correlated with each other. You know, if you have higher education level, then you're going to probably earn more money. You're going to probably be able to do a more complex job. But IQ is also associated with some things that you might not think it's associated with. You might be surprised by. And one of these is greater longevity. And so here, you know, you couldn't really use that argument and say, well, you know, good grades help you live longer or something. So what is this about? What's causing this greater longevity associated with higher IQ? People with higher IQs tend to live longer than people with lower IQs. So what could be causing this? Well, one explanation might be that they have better system integrity, meaning that whatever it is about their physical body that, you know, is related to their higher IQ is also better able to survive longer or something. Or it could be the case that they're better at managing their health. So it might be the case that people who are higher IQ are better able to avoid accidents, or they're better at preventing diseases, you know, through certain behaviors that they might practice, or certain knowledge that they might gain might allow them to avoid disease more effectively than other people. Or it could be the case that they have better access to resources. So because of their higher job status, higher income, they might be better able to get access to health resources. And it's probably not just one of these things that explains all of this. It's probably a combination of all of these factors. And one thing that we'll look at in the chapter on stress is we'll think about how people's role in society actually influences their longevity in terms of their position in the social hierarchy. So people who are higher status, who have higher status jobs, tend to live longer, and they tend to experience less stress. So that's something that would be likely to be related to this higher IQ correlation. But that's something that I'll come back to in the unit on stress. Okay, so when we look at the extremes of IQ, we do have some terms for talking about them. And so in the case of high IQ, the extremes would be considered anything over about 2 standard deviations above the mean. So for IQ, that would mean that somewhere around 130, scores that are higher than 130, that's 2 standard deviations above the mean, would be considered giftedness. So intellectual giftedness. Now, there's not actually a precise score for defining giftedness, but when we talk about people with higher IQ, often we're talking about this sort of higher extreme, this level of intellectual giftedness, but it's not saying that, you know, if you score 129, then you're not gifted, and if you score 130, then you are. There's not a precise value that defines it. But people who score in this range tend to generally have fulfilling lives, and they tend to be well-adjusted. And this goes against some stereotypes that people might have about very high IQ. So they might think that people with very high IQ are not socially adjusted, they don't have friends, they don't get along with others, they're sort of lonely and more likely to become depressed or things like that. And that's generally not the case for people with higher IQ. They tend to be fairly happy and well-adjusted and lead meaningful lives. Now, we have the other extreme of low IQ, and this is defined as intellectual disability. And the previous term that you probably heard is mental retardation, but that's not really used anymore. And the definition for intellectual disability would be an IQ score below 70, and that's 2 standard deviations below the mean or lower. And This is a range where people start having problems with completing everyday tasks. They may not be able to care for themselves. And we'll talk about intellectual disability a little bit more in the next video, and we'll talk about what causes these differences in IQ. Why is it that some people score in the IQ range that they do? And I won't have a full answer to that question, but we will look at some possible causes of intellectual disability and what that means for those people. So that's an overall summary of variation in IQ scores, how people differ, and the distribution of IQ scores in the population. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.